So we have been looking at multi-step methods, and yesterday I derived a specific result for fitting a local quadratic interpolation polynomial, and I showed that it could be done in different ways. So continuing our introduction with multi-step methods, I'm going to derive today a general formulation for multi-step methods for fitting any polynomial. But before that, I want to derive or point at one pattern. I'm going to change the notation a little bit. So I'll upload my notes with the change notation. Just to emphasize the fact that we are fitting a polynomial at each time instant, I already had that notation. I'm going to just shift the index n to a slightly, so time index is going to be emphasized now with a new notation. Otherwise, there's not much difference between the notation that we have used earlier. It's only the placement of this particular point. So we have been looking at this multi-step methods . We have this differential equation dx by dt is equal to f of xt, where x belongs to R. We are looking at a scalar differential equation, and our problem is to move from . This is my initial condition. I want to integrate over time. I want to integrate this initial value problem from Tn to Tn plus h, where h is the integration step size, the fixed integration step size. So we were looking at this polynomial interpolations, and now yesterday we looked at a specific polynomial interpolation. We looked at xt or xnt was a naught n plus I'm just moving this subscript n to time index n, just to emphasize that these are time varying coefficients. This is not one polynomial. At each time point, we are fitting, or we are having a different interpolation polynomial. It's a polynomial with time varying coefficients. That's another way of looking at it. We are not fitting one polynomial. Why quadratic? Well, I can choose to fit an interpolation polynomial of higher order. It's no trouble. Instead of doing this, I can choose xnt is equal to a naught n plus a1 n t plus a2 n t square plus . Well, I can fit a higher order, or I can develop a higher order interpolation polynomial. Okay, and then either extrapolate or estimate x n plus 1. Ultimately, what I want to do is move to x n plus 1. Okay, now to do this, how many unknowns are there in this polynomial? There are 5 unknowns, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Right? There are 5 unknowns, and then I need to get interpolation polynomial coefficient, I need to have 5 equations, right? I need to have 5 equations. So if I write 5 equations in 5 unknowns, then well, we made one modification yesterday. We just shifted the time scale. So if you define a new time scale tau, which is t minus tn. If I define a new time scale tau, which is t minus tn, then this becomes a polynomial in the shifted time scale tau. This will be tau, this will be tau square, this will be tau cube, and this will be tau to the power 4 if I use a shifted time scale. Okay. Now, to generate 5 equations in 5 unknowns, I can do it in many ways. For example, I can do this using, say, xn, xn minus 1, xn minus 2, fn. Okay? And I can decide to do this. Okay? I can decide to do xn, I can decide to use 4 derivatives, 1 xn. Okay? It's up to me how to generate the interpolation coefficients. I could use derivative terms, I could use, okay. I can use xn, xn minus 1, fn, fn plus 1. I could use any of these sets, okay? Any one of them will give me a valid way of constructing coefficients of the interpolation polynomial. If I use this set, or if I use this set, or if I use this set, I am not going to get identical polynomial, interpolation polynomials. Polynomials will be different, okay? What I want to indicate here is that there is no unique choice by which you develop this. Okay, it's up to you which way you want to go. Okay, suppose I decide to do using this set. Okay, I decide to do using this set. Then, I have 2 equations, or I have 5 equations. Now, we have this. We can differentiate this with respect to tau, and then that will give us equation, which is one more equation. Okay, and then using f and using x, okay, I can write 5 equations in 5 unknowns. Okay, if I happen to do it for this set, let's see what are those equations, and I'll just write down the final solution which you get after that. Okay. Algebraic manipulations are fairly simple, and you can do them by just doing elimination of variables. So if I actually go ahead and then at tau equal to 0, setting tau equal to 0, I get this x, a naught n comes out to be x n, and a 1 n comes out to be f n by following the same method which we have used earlier. Okay, so I substitute for tau. So what I do here is that at tau equal to 0 is nothing but t equal to tn. At t equal to tn is same as tau equal to 0. Okay, at tau equal to h, or t equal to tn plus h, we get fn plus 1 is equal to a1n plus 2h a2n plus 3h square a3n plus 4h cube a4n. Okay, I am just writing fn plus 1 by setting tau is equal to h, which is same as t is equal to tn plus h. Okay, this is the first derivative. Okay, I am just taking the derivative and substituted. See, if I take derivative of this, you can write f tau is equal to this is my expression for f tau. This is my expression for, yeah. No, it should be fn plus 1. I am just taking fn plus 1. I want to use fn plus 1, fn minus 1. Fn I have already used. I have used fn. If I see for fn, okay, fn, that is tau 0. Okay, tau 0 is fn. So this is 0, this should not be tau, this is 0, this is 0, this is 0, only a1n will remain. So you will get fn is equal to, tau 0 is equal to fn, is equal to a1n. So I have already used fn, I am now using fn plus 1, okay. So this is my equation number 1 will give me this, 2 is this. My equation 3 is this. Okay, I need two more equations. Okay, so two more equations can be, so I am going to generate two more equations, that is t is equal to tn minus h or tau is equal to minus h. For this point I get f n minus 1 is equal to a1n minus 2 this is my equation number 4 fn minus 1. Okay, and the last equation I am going to write is xn minus 1. So this is my fifth equation, xn minus 1, fn minus 1, fn plus 1, xn and fn. I am using 5 equations, okay, and I can solve them simultaneously. Actually a0n and a1n we got directly from the first two equations, okay. Then what remains is finding remaining 3, that is a2, a3 and a4, okay, which you can find out by simple elimination, okay. If you do an elimination with these as unknowns, okay, and h square, h cube or 3h square, minus 4h cube, these as coefficients, okay, then you can arrive at the four, you can arrive at a solution. I'll directly write the solution. The solution looks a little more complicated. Okay, so my A0 and A1n I already got here. Okay, my if I do the algebra, then my A2n this turns out to be 1/2 H Fn plus 1/6 Okay, this is my A2 and my A3n, it turns out to be Fn so this is A0, A1, A2, A3, just eliminate and then you have 5 equations in 5 unknowns, out of which 2 are directly the coefficients. So what remains is 3 equations in 3 unknowns. If you do elimination, you will get this just simple elimination and then find out okay. And my last coefficient here, that is A4n, this turns out okay. So finally, this is my polynomial A1n, A0n, A1n, A2n, A3n, A4n, and if I substitute that here, that is my polynomial. Okay. I have found out the local interpolation polynomial using 5 equations in 5 unknowns. This is one way of obtaining the coefficients. Okay. After having found this polynomial, see where I want to reach. I want to reach xn plus 1. So xn plus 1 is t is equal to tn plus h, so which corresponds to tau is equal to h. If I substitute tau is equal to h, I'll get value at tn plus 1. Tn plus 1, this is nothing but tn plus 1. This is my next point. Okay, so what I can do now is I can substitute all these coefficients into this polynomial. Okay, then substitute for tau is equal to h. Okay, and then I can regroup all the terms. Okay, they will collapse into a very simple equation. If you look here, What all things are appearing in my expression on the right hand side? If I substitute for A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, if I substitute, I will get Fn plus 1, Fn minus 1, Fn, xn and xn minus 1. These five things I'll get. Okay. So let me write, after substituting and regrouping, okay, I can write a very convenient form which is good for computations. This particular form which I have written is not very computation friendly. Okay, I'm going to arrive at a simpler form. So I'm going to transform this. I'm going to transform this into a simple formula. Xn plus 1 is equal to alpha 0 xn plus alpha 1 xn minus 1, okay, plus h times beta minus 1. This is just a notation. Beta minus 1 is just a notation. Fn plus 1 plus beta 0 fn plus beta 1 fn minus 1. I can rearrange this like this. Okay? I can rearrange that polynomial after substituting for tau is equal to h. I can rearrange it into this nice form. Okay? If I actually do substitutions, do all the rearrangement, take coefficients of the similar terms together, okay, then it collapses to a very simple formula, alpha naught equal to 0. Alpha 1 is equal to 1, beta minus 1 is equal to 1/3, beta naught is equal to 1/3, and beta 1 is equal to minus half. If I substitute and rearrange, okay, I get this. I would call this computable form. Is everyone with me on this, what I am doing? See, I am fitting a local interpolation polynomial. Local interpolation polynomial has been constructed using these values, xn, xn minus 1, fn, fn minus 1, fn plus 1. Okay? I found the polynomial, I substituted tau is equal to h, which gives me xn plus 1. Okay? And I am just rearranging and writing in a form which is more convenient for programming. Okay? Which is more convenient for programming. There is nothing wrong if you maintain this complex form. Okay? Nothing wrong, fundamentally nothing wrong if you maintain this complex form and every time substitute and find out. What you are going to get ultimately is same as this. Okay? In fact, all this time varying coefficient seems to don't show up when we write it like this. It appears that xn plus 1 is some linear combination of xn and past x values, fn plus 1, fn and past derivative values. All that is appearing is current, past and future derivative value and current and past x values. Okay, so my final form is going to always, whichever, you know, if I fit a 7th order polynomial, 8th order polynomial, 10th order polynomial, my final form will look something like this, xn, xn minus 1, maybe I have to take xn minus 2, xn minus 3, fn minus 1, fn minus 2, because I need to estimate all those coefficients, so I need so many other equations. So my final form is going to look always like this. Okay, can I work with this form directly instead of doing this complex interpolation polynomial derivations? Okay, that simplifies the derivation. Unfortunately, when you do it that way, it sometimes the polynomial form doesn't become visible. You just see this. But when you derive the formula, what you are actually doing is fitting an interpolation polynomial locally using either derivatives or x values. Okay, now let's derive a generic expression for fitting any mth order polynomial. Okay, and then we'll look at what is this. Just before we go ahead, what is this particular equation? Is this an explicit or implicit formulation? It's an implicit formulation because f f n plus 1 appears on the right hand side, which is function of x n plus 1. So to solve this, you have to do iterations and solve it iteratively. Okay. Okay. Let's move on to more general formulations. Okay. So I can generalize what we have got. I can say that whenever I am going to derive a multi-step method, in fact, if you write it in this form, the word multi-step becomes more clear why we are calling it multi-step method. I can write a general formula for a multi-step method, which is alpha naught xn plus alpha 1 xn minus 1 alpha p xn minus p plus h times beta minus 1 fn plus 1 plus beta 0 fn I can write a general formula for multi-step method, okay, which is linear combination of xn, xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3, whatever, up to p steps in the past, and fn plus 1, fn minus 1, up to p derivatives in the past. Okay, so we are finding out the new value, okay, not just using local derivative. We are basing our information based on past derivatives. We are basing our information on past x values. Okay, so the new value is constructed using some kind of local past information. Okay, how much you want to go in past, how many steps in the past, okay, will decide the accuracy of the method and so on. Okay, now how do you come up with a formula that will, how do you estimate, how do you estimate these coefficients? What are the unknowns here? Let's list the unknowns. Unknowns are alpha 0, alpha 1, to alpha p, beta minus 1, beta 0, beta p. How many unknowns are there? 2p plus 3 unknowns are there. Right? 2p plus 3 unknowns are there. So we need to solve this, we somehow had to construct 2p plus 3 equations. And okay, now in a more compact form, I am going to write xn plus 1 is equal to summation I going from 0 to p alpha I x n minus I plus summation I going from minus 1 to p beta I f n minus I. In fact, when I write it like this, this minus 1 beta minus 1 unusual notation will become clear why I am using beta minus 1. This is a compact way of expressing the same thing. Okay, now what I need to do is, of course, I am going to fit a local polynomial. Okay, my polynomial is going to be x n t let's work with shifted time scale such that tau is 0 and the same idea which we have done earlier. Okay, so my local polynomial is going to be a naught n plus let's consider mth order polynomial in general. Okay, let me consider mth order polynomial and p step method. Okay, I want to generalize this, which I can write as summation j going from 0 to m a j n t to the power j, right? This is a j n, n is only for the local coefficient, and this is my okay. What is f tau? What is f tau? F tau will be summation j going from 1, because initial term will be 0, d by dt of this will be 0. So j going from 1 to m, okay, it will be j times a j n t to power j minus 1, right? T to power j minus 1. Is everyone with me on this? Tau. Yes, this should be tau. Yeah, it should be the shifted time scale tau. So where our tau is, just to remind you, tau is t minus tn. Okay. So these are my, this is my f tau, this is my x tau. Okay. Now, using our notation, okay, let's write general expression. What is x n plus 1? X n plus 1, this will be a naught n plus a 1 n times h up to a correct. This is x n plus 1. What is x n minus i times in the past? How will you write this? It will be ih. Time will be ih. Rather, minus ih. Time will be minus ih. Okay? So, I am going to write this as j going from 0 to n. J going from 0 to n. Okay? A j n minus ih raised to j. Fine? I am just substituting for ith instant in the past. J going to 0 to m. J going to 0 to m, not to n. J going to 0 to m. Okay. Now, this I can do for I is equal to 0, 1, up to p. I can write this equation for each, xn minus 1, xn minus 2, xn minus 3, up to xn minus p. Right? So, how many such equations are there? P plus 1 equations are there. Okay. Then what about f? Fn minus i we just use that expression. Summation j going from minus 1 to minus 1 to m, summation j going from minus 1 to m, okay, j times j equal to, sorry, j is equal to 1 to m, p is minus 1 to, p goes from, sorry, I goes from minus 1 to, I goes from minus 1, minus 1 means f n plus 1, okay, f n plus 1, if I put I is equal to minus 1, I get f n plus 1, I put I is equal to 0, I will get f n, I get I is equal to 1, I will get f n minus 1, okay, because we are taking derivative at current point, next point and previous point and so on. So how many of these equations are there? P plus 2, okay, I have P plus 2 equations and yeah, okay, so what I am going to do now is I am just going to substitute these expressions. I am going to substitute these expressions, xn minus I, fn minus I, these summation expressions, okay. I am going to substitute them here, okay. I am going to substitute them here, okay, and then I am going to substitute this expression here, first one on the right side, this will be on the right side, these expressions will be substituted here, xn minus I, fn minus I, okay. Oh, there is one small correction. This expression here has h times, there is an h which I forgot to write when I wrote the generic expression. There is a iteration interval h will come here. So this is h times summation I going from minus 1 to p beta I I am just substituting this here. After that, what I am going to do is on the right hand side, we just, now this looks very complex expression, right? But the way we are going to simplify this is like this. See, look on the left hand side. You have h, h square, h cube up to h to the power m. I have h to the power m. Okay. On the right hand side also you will get if you look carefully, you will get maximum power of H will be H to the power m. Okay? You will have H to the power 0, H to the power 1, H to the power 2, H to the power 3. Okay? So, what I am going to do now, okay? I am going to arrange this, rearrange this. In between step, I am just leaving it for you to do the algebra. I will just explain this qualitatively. I am going to rewrite this complex right hand side as something plus something into H plus something into H square up to okay. I can do this because there are terms on the left hand side and right hand side which do not exceed h to power m. Okay, so I can take all the terms together, okay, and then if I want to get this equation for any h, what should happen? I should match the coefficients. Okay, so the first 0th coefficient should be matched with the 0th coefficient here, and so on. Okay, if I do that business of matching the coefficients, okay, I get following set of equations. If I just equate the coefficients, okay, one by one, I get this, how many equations I am expected to get? M plus 1 equations, because how many, see we have put mth order polynomial, okay, so I have M plus 1, I have M plus 1, how many equations I get here? These are M plus 1 equations, right? How many variables I have? 2p plus 3. Okay, number of constraints I got is m plus 1. Okay, number of constraints is m plus 1. Okay, and 2p plus 3 corresponds to number of two p plus three corresponds to the number of total number of variables. What are the variables? Alpha 0, alpha 1, alpha p, and beta minus 1, beta 0, beta 1 to beta p. These are the variables, and these are the equations that relate them. Okay, by taking a general multi-step method, these are the equations that relate them. So these are called as exactness constraints. So well, what you can guess is that you should have number of equations at least equal to number of unknowns. If number of unknowns is more, not a problem, you can fix some of them arbitrarily. Okay, if the number of unknowns are more, than the number of equations. You have to choose some arbitrarily. Okay, and but at least to get some tangible solution, you should have this equal to this. Okay, so I can generally give a condition to get a solution. Get a solution, we should have m plus 1 should be less than or equal to 2p plus 3. If number of unknowns is more, we can fix some of them arbitrarily. We can set something to 0 or whatever. Okay. Otherwise, they should be equal. These can be greater or these can be equal. And what is the condition for equality to hold? Okay. If you want equality to hold, then m plus 1 should be 2p plus 3. Okay, or order should be the polynomial order should be chosen. Okay, if you want a p-step method, okay, and if you want to get exact number of constraints, the polynomial order should be chosen. Okay, suppose I want one step method, if p is equal to 1, okay, then m should be 4. And so on. So this gives you a way of calculating what is the order of polynomial that you need to fit. Okay. Okay. So this is a generic derivation of multi-step methods. Now there are different classes of multi-step methods which are popular in the literature. Okay. We'll just have a look at them. One class of algorithms are called as Adams-Bashforth multi-step algorithms. Okay, so this is a class of algorithms. Okay, you choose parameters in a particular way. Okay, and together with the exactness constraints, we arrive at the polynomial coefficients and then get one method of integration. Okay, first of all, you should realize that what we have derived now is not one integration method. Okay, what we have derived is a way of arriving at integration methods. Choosing different number of different p, okay, will give you one particular method. Okay, if you choose 5 steps in the past, you will get one particular method. There is no unique way of getting those coefficients. Okay, so there are enough number of enough degrees of freedom so that you can have one method by each one can have one method by his own name if you choose to have that. Okay. So some of these are popular methods which are used in the literature. I'll just list them. But it's not that this is the only way to come up with the multi-step methods. So in this Adams-Bashforth explicit methods, in this methods we only use derivatives. We don't use x except one particular x. So we choose alpha 0 is equal to 1, alpha 1 is equal to alpha 2 equal to alpha p is equal to 0. Okay. In Adams-Bashforth method, we are not going to use past x values. We are going to use past only function values. Okay. And this is an explicit method, which means beta minus 1 is equal to 0. Okay, I am not going to use the future derivative. Okay. So if you put these constraints together with the earlier constraints, how many constraints are here now? P plus this will fall out. We can write now because the first equation will give you this alpha 0 is equal to 1, because your summation, you know, first equation is summation alpha I from 0 to p is 1. So the constraints that you have here are p plus 1 additional constraints. So total number of constraints m plus 1 original constraints we have, which I wrote, right, for j going from 0 to m, okay, plus these additional p plus 1 constraints. So this is m plus p plus 2, okay, and total number of variables is okay. So we also impose one more constraint here, that p is equal to m minus 1. This will fall out actually. P is equal to m minus 1. If you put p is equal to m minus 1, okay, you will get total number of equations and total number of constraints. And then, you know, you can set up those equations for Adams-Bashforth, and then finally the algorithm will look like this. Xn plus 1 is equal to xn plus h times beta 0 fn plus okay. Finally you will get beta 0, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 for a pth order method. If you some of the books will list these coefficients, okay, or you can derive them by setting up the constraints. I have given here the equation. You get a linear algebraic equation, okay, in 2 plus m variables, in 2 plus m, 2m plus 1 variables, in 2m plus 1 unknowns. You can solve them together and then you can get the these coefficients. These coefficients will be listed in any one of the books. Likewise, we will talk about implicit methods. Those implicit methods are called Adams-Moulton methods. Those are implicit methods, okay. And then implicit method will be one which requires xn plus 1 in the future to be estimated. So what you do is, you know, you tie them up. When you are solving the implicit method, you use an explicit method to get initial guess and then solve the implicit method iteratively. Okay, so that's why it's called prediction correction methods also. You do a prediction using explicit method, use the prediction in the implicit method as initial guess and do a correction. Okay, we'll come to this idea next class. There's another class of methods called Gears method. Gears method are the one in which you don't use past function values, you use past x values and only one function value. Those class of methods are called as Gears method. These class of methods are called as Adams, Moulton, Adams, Bashforth, and so on. Okay. So we'll look at these classes, which are popular classes, and then we'll move on to the next method.